Good morning. In our previous lesson, there was an 8.0 Newton force of drag acting on an automobile.
Flippin' physics!
Now we are going to show how we calculated that force of drag. Bobby, what is the equation for the force of drag?
The force of drag equals 1/2 times the density of the medium through which the object is traveling, times the magnitude of the velocity of the object squared, times the drag coefficient of the object, times the cross-sectional area of the object.
Let's start with the density of air, which is the medium through which the car was traveling. The density of air depends on the air temperature, and the temperature of the air was 67 degrees Fahrenheit. However, we need the temperature of the air in degrees Celsius. Billy?
Well, to get the temperature in degrees Celsius, subtract 32 from the temperature in degrees Fahrenheit and multiply that quantity by 5/9. In this case, that's 67 minus 32 multiplied by 5 divided by 9. It's 19.4 repeating, or roughly 19 degrees Celsius.
According to Engineering Toolbox, 1.2 kilograms per meter cubed is a good approximation of the density of air at 19 degrees Celsius. Now let's talk about capital D, the drag coefficient. The drag coefficient, like the coefficient of friction, is an experimentally measured value. Basically, the easier it is for air to move around an object, the lower that object's drag coefficient. According to Ecomotor, 0.25 is the drag coefficient of a 2011 Toyota Prius, which is, if you look at the list, one of the lowest drag coefficients listed for a typical automobile. A, the cross-sectional area, or the area perpendicular to the direction the object is moving, is also listed on Ecomotor. It is 23.4 feet squared. Now, unfortunately, when I wrote the scripts for these two videos, I accidentally misread the number as 21.6 feet squared. And unfortunately, it's not really worth redoing both of the videos for that small typo. I'm sorry. So we multiply the cross-sectional area by the square of the quantity 1 meter over 3.281 feet. To get a cross-sectional area of 2.00651 meters squared. Now, notice how all three of these variables are constant as the vehicle accelerates. However, the magnitude of the velocity is not constant as the vehicle accelerates, and the velocity is squared in the force of drag equation, which means we can't just use an average velocity to figure out the average force of drag. Instead, what we need to do is graph the force of drag as a function of time in order to figure out the average force of drag. We do this by determining the time at which the car's speedometer reading changed. You can see it changed to 2 kilometers per hour at 1.10 seconds, 3 kilometers per hour at 1.38 seconds, 4 kilometers per hour at 1.67 seconds, 6 kilometers per hour at 1.95 seconds, and we continue to do that until the car has reached 30 kilometers per hour at a measured distance of 42 meters from where the car started. For legibility's sake, I am only going to include the first few data points in our data table here. If you want to see the rest of the data table, please use the lecture notes by following the link which just appeared. Now, we need the instantaneous speed in meters per second. So we multiply each instantaneous speed by 1 hour over 3,600 seconds and 1,000 meters over 1 kilometer. And now we have everything we need in order to find the instantaneous force of drag at every time interval. We multiply 1/2 times the density of the air, 1.2, times the square of the instantaneous speed at each time, times the drag coefficient of 0.25, times the cross-sectional area of 2.00651. And you can see we have the instantaneous force of drag at each time. The next step is to graph the force of drag as a function of time. The equation for the best fit curve, as reported by our spreadsheet program, is y equals 0.2275 times x squared plus 0.3187 times x. However, we don't really have a y-axis. Instead, we have a force of drag axis. And instead of an x-axis, we have a time axis. Therefore, this equation should really be reported as the force of drag equals 0.2275 times time squared plus 0.3187 times time. If we take the definite integral of the force of drag with respect to time from 0 to 9.25 seconds, which is the total time of the event, we will get the area between the curve and the time axis. The definite integral works out to be 73.653 Newton seconds. Again, this is the area between the curve and the time axis. The definite integral of the force of drag with respect to time is equal to the average force of drag times the total change in time. This is because the average force of drag times the total change in time creates a rectangle with the same area as the definite integral of the force of drag with respect to time. I'll say that again because it is very important. The rectangular area in pink created by the average force times the total change in time has the same area, 73.653 Newton seconds, as the yellow area between the curve and the time axis, which is the definite integral of the force of drag with respect to time. Okay, going back to the equation. Dividing by change in time gives us the average force of drag equals the integral of the force of drag with respect to time divided by change in time, or 73.653 divided by 9.25, which is 7.962 or 8.0 newtons with two significant digits. That is how I solved for the average force of drag acting on an accelerating vehicle. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.